Hey crew, I've got the key to that Ford Bronco Raptor. Had to. We are gonna take it for a drive, but first, let's check it out what looks on the inside and outside. Up front is a letterbox grille with Ford on it. Then we have these LED projector headlights with LED DRLs and turn signals. Those are above these modular steel bumpers with removable end caps. Down low are Rigid Industries LED fog lights, two integrated tow hooks, more steel bash protection down low. Up top is a hood bulge with the optional graphics package, functional heat extraction there, and even more of it here on the side with these shark gills. And those are above the comically large, almost silly looking fender flares. But I mean, you do what you gotta do to wrap over the 37-inch BF Goodrich KO2 all-terrain tires. And those are over the 17-inch beadlock capable wheels that are an option. And with six easy bolts, you can take off those metal side steps if you're gonna do some rock crawling, then you've got the rock sliders beyond them. The door mirrors are mounted up here and not on the door, so you can easily remove those four doors. More graphics there on the side, and it's weird to say, but I'm kind of into it. Not usually into graphics, but kind of works with this truck. In profile, those 37s just give it this authority on and off-road. At the back, well, before we get to the back, see that orange peeking through? For the Fox Live Valve remote reservoir suspension. The taillights are LEDs. Then you've got Raptor badging, a full 37-inch spare tire on the swing-out tailgate, two tow hooks, and a hitch receiver. You can tow up to 3,500 pounds. Just wide. It's so wide. It strikes fear into the hearts of pedestrians. Let's look at the interior. Opening up and looking inside at this navy blue leather interior with burnt orange accents and perforated suede seat inserts. More navy blue here for these padded portions, then black hard plastics. You get netted pouch for storage, and with the sidestep and the grab handle, it is easy to get up and in. Behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, I have solid knee room, good sized foot pockets to slide my feet under. Thigh support is acceptable. I wish the seat bottoms were just a little longer. Headroom is excellent. And of course you can have infinite headroom by removing these panels. You've got one single one here over the rear seats and then two over the front seats. In the back, we've got no air vents. We do have two power windows and then two USB ports, one A1C and then an AC outlet there. Rubberized floor mats here going over the drive shaft hump, which you do have to get over to get into the middle seat. And I can fit, though with three full-size adults in the back, it would be a tight squeeze. If you don't have someone in the middle, there is an armrest that comes down with padding and two cup holders. I like the back seats. I'll just say I wish we had rear air vents and I wish these seat backs reclined. Let's check out the front. Door close noise. Wow, surprisingly solid. Pulling on the swing out tailgate, I mean, you really have to pull hard to overcome the strut and the 37-inch tire. Lift up the back glass and we find 52 cubic feet of space behind the 60-40 split folding rear seats, which you do have to reach all the way in there or maybe even climb all the way in the back. Under the rubberized floor mats, we find just a bit of extra storage for your tools. Then we've got a DC outlet over here. Pull down the glass and pull hard once again. Moving up front, we have some beefy looking sport bucket seats, well bolstered, they're heated and power adjusting. Then you've got your Ford Performance tread plate, same material quality on the front doors as the back with the optional carbon fiber interior package. You get this matte carbon fiber trim around your rubberized grab handle that makes it easy to get up front. We've got a digital instrument cluster here that is reconfigurable. And then we've got some injection molding with contrast stitching up top. All of your off-road mode settings are there. You've got another USB port to wire up a GoPro or something. Bronco with the burnt orange accents on the passenger side. Then here we've got a 12-inch touchscreen infotainment that is fairly responsive. It's very easy to use. It does have wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Down lower, you've got your volume knob and settings, your seat heating and climate controls, wireless smartphone charging pad, and then you've got two more USB ports, one A, one C, more matte carbon fiber around your gear selector. And then over here, we've got two cup holders, your drive mode selections, window controls, door mirror controls, and then under the Raptor injection molded armrest, we have quite deep storage. Visibility is excellent. Plus, those rear seat headrests do fold, and you've got standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. Other notables, we've got 6 pre-wired auxiliary switches and a thickly leather-wrapped steering wheel, just great size in the hands, small diameter, got that matte carbon fiber there, burnt orange accents here and here. This cabin just has tons of character and flair. Yeah, you've got some cheaper materials, but they hide them pretty darn well. I'm excited. Let's take the Bronco Raptor for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. Well, it's certainly no V8 in the startup, but the 6-cylinder tries. It's pretty deep. Some animations on the infotainment, and we are live. For our drive modes to get things started, turn your goat mode setting here, and you can see we'll be in normal. And then furthermore, you've got these configurations on the wheel. We're gonna leave everything in the normal setting. The only thing you can make even more relaxed than normal would be the steering. You can have that in comfort, so it's even less resistance. Pull back the gear selector into reverse, and that brings up a high resolution camera system. You got your bird's eye view off to the right. You can see I did in fact make it between the lines of the parking space, and that is not easy to do in the Bronco Raptor. Then you've got your backup with trajectory lines. You can also go in here and get different views. You can have it take over the whole screen and have an ultra wide angle. That's for the back and the front. Down into drive. And like normal, we're gonna start off with a turning radius test. Goodness, that is a remarkably fine turning radius. I mean, you think about the 37-inch tires having to turn within their wheel arches. The articulation of those in there is pretty impressive. Good turning radius to start us off. So yeah, okay, hard to fit between the lines of a parking space, but you know, you can at least maneuver pretty easily. Turn signal sound. I like it. A gentle tap. How about the world famous horn test? Oh, okay. That was a horn that wanted to be heard. Powertrain in the Ford Bronco Raptor. We have a 3-liter twin turbocharged 6-cylinder. It makes 418 horsepower and 440 pound-feet of torque. Those are increases of 88 horsepower and 25 pound-feet over the 6-cylinder non-Raptor Bronco. Just as I'm thinking of it. Brake pedal, easy to modulate, not too grabby. And the start-stop system, which has been activated right now, kicks off imperceptibly in the background, and then when you take your foot off the brake, it turns back on. You hear it, but you don't really feel a big rattle in the cabin as you're getting moving. You can, of course, overwrite that as well by just hitting the start-stop function. And then the way you can tip in on the throttle in normal mode is smooth. And the 10-speed automatic that is paired with the 6-cylinder works mostly in the background. If you do go into the sport drive mode, you feel the gear changes a bit more and it holds on to those gears for longer. But when just daily driving, it's an afterthought. The ride quality with this Haas suspension system and the Fox Live Valve remote reservoir shocks is, hate to use the term, shockingly good. That was bad.
Yeah, it is quite good. Now you think they could have made the suspension so stiff to compensate for the perceived action of taking the Bronco Raptor on jumps and needing to absorb the impact so that the ride quality around town was sacrificed. But somehow they found a sweet middle ground here where, yeah, you feel the bumps, but they're not truly disruptive to the enjoyment of the drive. The only downside to the suspension is that it's a little bit bouncy over certain things. Like, it continues to bounce the chassis after going over the bump, but it's fully tolerable. Should we see how quick the Bronco Raptor gets to 60? For that activity, I've got my race box set up here. I'm gonna hit the Raptor button twice to put us in the custom mode, and then it'll give us a little brake boost and send it away. Not a lightning bolt, and not even my quickest 0-60 test. Now, I've done it both ways. One, where I just laid my foot in it, and two, where I did what I did just back there, give it a little brake boost. The downside to the brake boost is that you do chirp the tires and lose that initial momentum, but the downside to just laying in it is that it takes a while for the boost to build up and give you all of the power at your disposal. So, the Raptor is not the quickest 0-60 accelerating vehicle within its competitive set, but that doesn't mean it's slow. The mid-range is strong, and when that boost has built up, it can carry you forward quite quickly. What do we think about the soundtrack, though? It's a distinct noise, to be sure, but is it something that I would desire? Whereas I love the 392 Hemi's V8 soundtrack, this is something that I'm like, it's noise, and I'll take noise over silence most of the time. But this isn't a soundtrack that I crave. We should see about how these brakes hold up. From around 60, saw a little water come up from when I recently washed the truck. So there is just an incredible amount of nosedive. And I mean, you can anticipate it because this is a lifted truck, but that's quite a lot of it. And furthermore, there's a wiggle, a defined wiggle when you're fully hard on those brakes. Now, before we go kick some dirt onto these exceedingly wide fender flares, we've got one last box to check for the Raptor on road, and that is to see how it ambles down a highway. So at these higher speeds, you can indeed hear a lot of wind noise, road noise, and tire hum. The levels of NVH in here are not what I would say any worse, and they may even be a little better than the Wrangler with the Extreme Recon package on the 35-inch tires. But they are at a point where if you're coming out of another competitor to this vehicle, the Land Rover Defender, this is going to sound like you're in the eye of a storm. And if you're having a conversation with your passengers, your voices are just naturally going to raise, or if you're just by yourself, you're going to have to crank that sound system because it's just loud. Now, one thing that is distinctly better than the Wrangler is how you're operating the steering wheel. Because of that independent front suspension compared to the solid axles in the Wrangler, I do not have to be busy with the steering to keep the vehicle pointed straight. And even though it's 7 feet wide, I can stay within the lines because it's so easy to point this truck. And that puts you much more at ease if you do have to commute in the Bronco Raptor. It won't be nearly as tedious as the Wrangler. And when we go back to the sport powertrain setting, we can see that when I put my foot down, it can drop down a number of gears just like that. It went from 10th gear to 5th gear. And then held it so rapidly. Furthermore, if you do want to go into manual mode and pull on these big plastic but big paddles, the gear changes are rapid. I had zero expectation of gear changes this quick from the Bronco Raptor, but it makes it such that you want to actually use it in manual mode. Some manual modes, you just kind of want to leave them. This one is just fun. And then the last piece of the highway driving puzzle, we do have features like adaptive cruise control and a lane keep assist system as standard in the Raptor. You can experience those in my PV Night Drive along with this 10 speaker sound system. Now, without further delay, let's get some dirt on these tires. And just like that, our scenery has changed. And I know so many of you want to see a Bronco Raptor jump. So I'll give that to you right now. We're going to change up the drive mode, go into not just off-road. Let's go all the way to Baja, which is going to perk up the throttle response, brings up a front-facing camera system, puts us in four-wheel drive high, and turns off traction control so we can get into some shenanigans. Let's have some. Oh, hang time is such a wonderful thing. Especially when it's complemented by pillow soft landings. And that's what we have in the Bronco Raptor. You get the air, you have the fun, you feel the butterflies in your stomach, and then you just sort of float on down. The other thing the Bronco Raptor does extraordinarily well is fly down dirt or washboardy roads. You can swing the tail around. Hoot and holler to your heart's content. And I mean, don't get me wrong, this is a lot of fun. But the best part is knowing that this is just a foretaste of the Raptor's talents, because you don't have to be that nice to it. You don't have to stick to just dirt roads. You can take it far, far off them. With that said, let's now get into some of our other off-road goodies. So I'm going to change it up from Baja to just the standard off-road mode, and that is going to lock up the rear differential. I could also lock the front differential, and then I'll move us into four-wheel drive low. Got to go to neutral for that shift. We're good. Back into drive. And that, once again, brings up the front-facing camera system. Is four-wheel drive low entirely necessary for this hill? Not with all the power we have at our disposal, but it does make for a very easy trip up this slope. You can just gently caress the throttle pedal, and it will work its way up. We do have a crawl ratio of 67.9 to 1 in four drive low. You can also thank our 43 degrees of approach angle 26 degrees of breakover and 37 degrees of departure for allowing you not really to have to worry that you're going to bottom out on anything. And if you ever did, well, you take off those side steps to increase the breakover. Now, for tighter turns like this, you could use the trail turn assist feature. And when you hit that, it will break the inner wheel and allow you to just pivot to do things in one fell swoop that would take you multiple. Now for the descent, we can use the trail control feature. So I'll hit the button in the middle. And this also has a one pedal function where it will make the vehicle stop completely unless you're actually giving it gas. And then we'll bring you back down to a stop the moment you take your foot off the throttle, or you can just set the speed at which you wish to descend in half mile per hour increments. Again, not touching the throttle, not touching the brake, just focusing on steering here. Very useful for maintaining a consistent momentum down the hill, not creating a slide if you're too quick and then slamming on the brakes. And having the trajectory of your tires shown on the front-facing camera is extremely useful. And if that first hill wasn't steep enough for you, we can try something a little tougher. We're going to lock up not just the rear, but also the front differential to give us as much traction as possible, mitigate that slip. And then if articulation was an issue, the front tires, you can disconnect the front sway bar. Here, I don't think that's going to be quite as much a problem. So with those locked up, let's get to climbing. It's hard to tell on camera, guys. But this is pretty straight up. And the Raptor just made quick work of it. After a while, behind the wheel of the Bronco Raptor off-road, you just come away with this sense that there's not really many obstacles this truck couldn't overcome. And that fills you with this confidence that your fun will never really be cut short. And now I want to talk about a new segment of the Miles Per Hour POV Drives that I plan to introduce. And that is the Miles Per Hour Word of the Day. If you've been watching these videos for a while, you'll notice that I like using interesting terminology. I appreciate diction, word choice. I think language is important for conveying things in a more immersive way than just saying them flatly or with simple terms. So, I'm going to try to come up with a word for each vehicle that I'm driving that I feel suits it appropriately. Today's word is going to be audacious, because from the way it looks to the way it performs on and off-road, particularly off-road, the Bronco Raptor is audacious. It is forthright. It is transparent. It is unabashed about the things that it can do and the way it wants to go about them. Which is just so very gleeful! Oh my gosh! Oh, I think I'm in love. Now, before we just phone this one in, hauling it a win for the Raptor, we do need to see what it's up against in pricing and competition. And we also have yet to share the fuel economy. That's 15 mpg in the city, 16 here on the highway, and 15 combined. The top speed is 114 miles per hour. The starting figure for the Bronco Raptor is $70,000. That is about double the starting figure of your base Bronco four-door, and this one as tested is $80,000. But before you get upset about that price, I defy you to try to look at the spec sheet and attempt to build your own Raptor for anywhere close to the starting figure of this truck, to have it be the same level of refinement and capability as this factory vehicle just can't be done. If you can do it, you pull it off, let me drive it and I'll happily eat my words. Other vehicles you might consider. I've already mentioned both of these briefly, but we'll dive in deeper. The Jeep Wrangler Rubicon 392 Extreme Recon. That one starts at $76,000. It makes 475 horsepower. It gets to 60 in a segment, quickest 4.5 seconds. But the fuel economy, that's just 14 combined mpg. Then we've got the Land Rover Defender 110, and I'm going to say the V8 model. That is the most expensive, $107,000 to start. It does make the most power, 518 horses. It gets to 60 in 4.9 seconds, and somehow, with a supercharged V8, it manages to get 16 combined mpg. Now, the Raptor is not perfect. I shared with you a few of the things that I didn't love about it. On road, we've got the braking, that under hard braking, it gets a little squirrely there. The cabin, as we're experiencing here on the highway, is quite loud. Not gonna say it's any louder than the Wrangler, but it is loud. The acceleration is not the quickest in the segment, and the soundtrack is also not sultry. Furthermore, off-road, the only thing it gives up to that Wrangler is the crawl ratio. The Wrangler Extreme Recon has a crawl ratio of 100 to 1, meaning it can just incrementally scamper up very intense or steep obstacles that the Raptor might have a little extra difficulty with. But you know what? Momentum, you can probably cure all those problems. It is not going to be the vehicle you'll feel comfortable parking in front of a valet at a nice restaurant. That would be the Defender 110 V8. But from all other regards, the Raptor is just easy to live with, impressive to look at, and insanely, insanely capable off-road. I love this truck. It is close with that Wrangler 392 simply for that soundtrack of the Hemi motor. But this one just takes the edge. It takes the win for me. I hope you guys have enjoyed this PUV drive review. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. And I'll see you next time.